Christ is risen. This is class 20 of our Orthodox Survival course. We've been going through the intellectual and to some extent the social history of Western Europe since the break in the Middle Ages of the Western Church from Orthodoxy. Now we've arrived at the period we call the Age of Revolution. Remember in our last class we talked about, the last couple of classes, about the age of the so-called Enlightenment. The 17th and 18th century, whose philosophy, whose ideas laid the groundwork for the age that started in 1789 with the French Revolution. And the French Revolution, really, beginning in 1789, is the inauguration of a whole period of open revolt against a Christian order in society. Because up to that point, there had been secret conspiracies, secret societies, individuals who were planning for this. But then in 1789, it comes out into the open, where they openly say, we want a society without church, without Christ, without God, without the king, without family. Originally, the people don't realize how radical the original agenda of the French Revolution was. They were going to abolish marriage and families as well, which also was part of the original agenda of the Bolsheviks in Russia. So all these revolutions always had these things in common. They want the destruction of the church, the destruction of the traditional order of society, and the destruction of the family. And tonight we're going to do an overview of the ideas of the age of the revolution. And then starting in our next class, we'll talk about the French Revolution itself and some of the key ideas and what actually occurred at that time. And as Orthodox people, this is important to us on two fronts. One front is the front that we live in the modern so-called Western world that was created by this age of revolution. We're still in it. We're now in the further stages of it, advanced stages of it. Okay. Another reason historically for us and for self-understanding is that many of our Orthodox nations came into being during this period, where it's for centuries in the Balkans. Our Orthodox peoples had been under the dominion either of the Ottoman Turks or of the Austrians. And then in this age of the 19th century, they arrive at a separate political existence with their own kings, their own parliaments, and so forth and so on. But it's important to realize that even though the revolutions were presented to the common people as fights for Orthodoxy and for Christianity and for their nation against a foreign or a heretical or a pagan oppressor, many of those who organized and instigated the revolutions that created our modern Orthodox countries were themselves not either apostate Orthodox or secretly Masonic, people who were nominally Orthodox but secretly Freemasons, or they were just simply Westerners who came from the West and who themselves were of the revolutionary mindset. So if it had been just a revolution to overthrow foreign or non-Orthodox rule and have a completely Orthodox society, that would have been a very good thing. But it was, from the beginning, it was mixed in with these, not only the ideas, but actually the people, societies, associations, and so forth. One good question to ask yourself, for example, is why did they give foreign kings?
That's what I was going to say.
Why, if it was an Orthodox movement, why were there, who brought in foreign kings, you see, for example? But we need to have a whole session just on this question of the birth of the modern Orthodox nations that came to being in the 19th century. But tonight let's do an overview of these revolutionary ideas. As a prelude, even though this isn't in the notes, I want to mention that we're starting with 1789 and not 1776, not the independence of the United States. Why? Because the American Revolution is not a pure revolution it's not as useful to study the American Revolution as to study the French Revolution. The French Revolution is a full-blown revolutionary attack on the traditional order of society. The American revolutionists were not advocating a complete overthrow of the traditional order of society. They simply wanted to secede from the British Empire and govern their local communities, their states and local communities on a local level in using Republican methods, using legislatures, town hall meetings and so forth and so on. But to a very great extent, the American Revolution did not overthrow the traditional order of society. Their life went on much as it had before. Whereas the French Revolution, its overt stated purpose and its methods, which were brutal and which were cataclysmic, were very bloody and very violent and radical, was the opening shot, you might say, in the open revolt against a Christian order in society in the Western world. One might say that we've been studying an age of revolution in the sense of an age of revolt ever since we began our study of the second millennium with the High Middle Ages in the West, which involved the fateful turn of Western Europe onto the path of creating a gradually ever more worldly version of the Christian faith, and therefore the gradual secularization of culture. So, yes, they made theological changes, heresies, and they broke with the Orthodox Church. Then century by century, as we saw in our study of the Renaissance and then the Enlightenment period, there's a gradual secularization of culture, where the church becomes more and more worldly, and her ideas and her presentation of herself becomes worldly, and the society becomes more separated from the influence of the church. And there's a growing effort to create some kind of a heaven on earth, some kind of a magnificent, successful worldly culture. Remember our discussion of the model of Paterim Sorokin about ideational versus sensate cultures. And the Western culture, say from the end of the Middle Ages until the cataclysms of the 20th century, the vast wars, the revolutions, which were really the destruction of the Western European culture, in that 500-year period, is one of the most brilliant periods of sensate culture, in many ways unsurpassed in world history, so far as achievements in technology and organization, the growth of population, and the ability of one group of people, which is from really a tiny part of the earth. Think of that little northwestern corner of the Eurasian landmass, and that tiny group of people to in 500 years to spread their political, economic, and cultural domination of the whole world. See, so it's a brilliant sensate achievement, but it's secular. It's more and more secular as time goes on. Even when done in the name of spreading Christianity or the name of spreading missions, it's increasingly a very humanistic or secularistic Christianity, which ultimately doesn't have the power to resist overt revolution because it becomes more spiritually empty on the inside. So though the papacy, and after the Reformation, the state Protestant churches were usually, though not always, but usually the conservative or reactionary counterweight against the next phase of revolution, the next phase of secularism, whether Renaissance, Enlightenment, Revolution, they were themselves part of the dialectic. They're part of that tit-for-tat process. Remember Hegel's idea of thesis, antithesis, synthesis, right? So the secularists present their thesis, the church fights back with the antithesis, but then there's a new synthesis. It's always in the direction going down spiritually, right, into greater and greater secularism. Not being of divine origin, the heretical Western churches could not resist the demonic forces that century by century were preparing European culture to become the worldwide ideology of Antichrist. There is a saying in Latin, corruptio optimi pessima, the corruption of the best becomes the worst. Wait, you want to see the worst? It's the corruption of the best. Okay. Who's the devil? The devil was the highest cherub, right? And who are the people who hate Christians the most? Apostate Christians. See, Europe, which had received the faith so early, whose nations and cultures were created by the church, became the seedbed and nursery of what today has become a virulent, anti-Christian, demonic culture of nihilism. Okay. Friedrich Nietzsche is considered the father of nihilism. Right? He's not the descendant of Muslims. He's not a descendant of Buddhists, Hindus, so forth. He's a descendant of Christians. Right? was himself a baptized Christian. I don't remember if Nietzsche was Lutheran or Catholic, probably Lutheran. But this is where the anti-Christianity comes from, is from Europe. Okay. So Europe's technological, military, and economic power spread over all the earth, bringing with it a heretical Christianity, which, by the way, did do, on the human level, did do a lot of good. They built thousands of hospitals, orphanages, schools. You know, it was, they, you can't deny this, right? You'd be very ignorant or very obtuse, right, to deny the outward good that these people did, right? But it was more and more spiritually an empty Christianity, you see. It was more and more secular.
It's like mousetrap, you put the cheese.
You put the cheese in it. Well, or it was like something that forgot what it was for. It forgot why they forgot why they were doing it, right? It became more and more humanistic. There's a funny term. The 19th century Victorian Englishman said they practiced a muscular Christianity. It's muscular. They were going around the world, being strong and brave, and you know, while they were climbing mountains. The 19th century English were amazing people, right? They were climbing mountains and charting whole sections of continents that had never been mapped before, and taking over whole countries. You know, a few Englishmen with a squad of soldiers could take over a whole African country, and in a few weeks. But they were very proud of spreading their form of Christianity, which was Anglicanism, which is a very very culturally refined but spiritually empty form of Christianity, and whose progressive wing was extremely humanistic and extremely given to theological deviation. So there were the British, who spread. There was the British Empire, the largest empire in history, and that's now been succeeded by the American Empire, so which kind of took over from the Americans took over from their British cousins this vast sea empire or this foreign empire, and so this culture, this secular culture, was spread by the Anglophone people. This secularism was spread through the whole world, and then of course, the old Catholic countries, Spain, Portugal, had conquered large parts of the world, all of Latin America, the Philippines, and so forth. And they brought their Roman Catholic Christianity to these countries, which was less secular, less humanistic than Protestantism, but still, compared to Orthodoxy, is secular and humanistic. Especially the very institution of the papacy is a worldly conception, a utopian humanistic conception of God's rule on earth, which is why the Orthodox always saw the Pope as a type, a typos of the Antichrist. Okay. So we see the European Christians brought this heretical Christianity, or forms of it, right, and to the whole world, but it could not resist the seeds of Antichrist revolt that's already present. The seeds of the Antichrist revolt are already in even the best of the Western Christianity, right, because they separated from Orthodoxy. We see today that the leadership of the false official churches, all the big shots, right? They're part and parcel of the anti-Christian global elite. They're in the club, right? They're part of the club, right? Which is not really surprising. But that shouldn't surprise us, see? Because it's a logical outcome of the tendency of their direction, their trajectory, for so many centuries, right? To be in there, to be a geopolitical player, to be part and parcel of the world. Okay. Father Seraphim Rose would often say that our biggest enemy is our worldliness. Our biggest enemy is our worldliness. Right? Of course, official heresy is a great enemy, and we have to flee it, get away from it. Of course, thinking and officially or openly teaching errors on the dogmatic level is very terrible. Because it deprives us of grace. It separates us from the truth, from Christ. But what makes us open to these errors is our worldliness, right? Because we want to accommodate error to get along, because we don't want to lose our comforts, see? And so the whole Western world was prepared for this, you see, through centuries of very successful material culture. Which made people very comfortable. Okay. Until the age of revolution, however, the revolution was not a public, openly admitted reality. They didn't openly, the progressive element, there are so-called progressive elements in every European society. The people who are secretly saying, you know, we don't want the church, we don't want God telling us what to do, we don't want these traditions from our ancestors, we want to create this new way, right? But they were operating in secret, right? Officially, everybody, even the revolutionists, right? Officially, everybody was in favor of the Christian institutions in both church and state. Even the members of the secret societies who were conspiring against the church and the state. We must also remember that these revolutionary movements only existed in the tiny leadership class, a little tiny sliver of the society, among the progressive aristocracy and liberal clergy, and what we could call the intellectual prostitutes, right? The academics, the authors, the journalists, the usual suspects, right? And above all these people, their real masters, who are the growing real power, which were the bankers, right? The financiers, the bankers, the people who control the money, the growth of the money power. We discussed this earlier. We're talking about the advent of the absolutist, divine right monarchies of early modern Europe. Right, this idea of a king with the divine right of kings, which is a modern idea. That's not the medieval or ancient idea that the king is absolute and that he answers. Only to God, he's not bound by the traditions or the inherited constitution of the nation. But these early modern kings had these big bureaucracies, and for the first time in history, these big modern armies, big professional modern armies that needed lots of money for the technology. Because starting with the late Middle Ages, starting really in the 15th century, Europe is on a long arms race that's going on even till now, right? This arms race we're in now, where they keep building bigger and bigger weapons and more of a nation's wealth goes into weapons. This goes all the way back to the late Middle Ages, really back to the 15th century. You know, this Constantinople fell to the sound of cannon fire. And they needed money. And so the money power comes to the fore. And more, even though it's not admitted, it's the people with the money. It's not the kings, and it's not the bishops, and so forth. But it's actually the people who control the flow of money, and who understand how to manipulate money, that are become the real power. And they are the ones who are actually funding the revolutionary movements that are overthrowing the church and state that the bankers are also funding. See, so more and more the social and political life becomes sort of a front for other processes that are going on that are not officially acknowledged. And to some extent, even today, you're not supposed to officially acknowledge them, right? Okay. So, but that's a tiny percentage of the people. Back before the French Revolution, the vast mass of people, still primarily agrarian, they're farmers, right? Are small tradesmen, craftsmen. They were living in their traditional ways, and they remained close to their church. Even the Catholics and the Protestants, they remained close to their church. They led simple lives. Their lives weren't much different from their Orthodox ancestors, right? Their attitudes, their approach to life, right? They're traditionally patriotic. They're traditionally royalist. You know, it's a big myth. It's a huge propaganda myth that the French people, for example, were in an uproar and turmoil, and they were starving, and they hated the king because Marie Antoinette was using their money to buy beautiful dresses, and they were all starving, and so they had to overthrow the king and chop off the king's head. This is a myth, right, created by propagandists. And it's fed to us through school, through the books and so forth. But if you actually read sources from that time, including even enemies of the French, like English travelers who traveled to France, even though, yes, there were huge management problems, huge financial problems in the governance of France. But on the local level, the village level, the people were very strong. Their traditions were very strong. And they still revered the ancient monarchy, and they revered their church. See? So all these revolutions of the people, so-called, starting in 1789, were never popular movements. They were never popular movements. You look at the people... the people who were on the barricades in Paris in 1848, they weren't peasants. They weren't simple people. They were students, right? They were intellectuals. They were apostate seminarians, right? They were foreigners. And many of them actually were non-Christians. They were from another people, another race. Okay. So these so-called revolutions of the people were never popular movements. They were coups. And we all know from history, we know from recent history, that a small group of people can very successfully engineer a coup and overthrow an entire nation, take over an entire nation, right? These coups are engineered by demonically enlightened and malicious, a malicious minority of privileged people, okay, evildoers, who seize the levers of power and they destroy the traditional protectors of the people, the altar and the throne, right, the church and the king. Then they tyrannize the majority through ruthless violence. We had the French Revolution, where they chopped off the heads of thousands and thousands and thousands of people within a few years. All kinds of people, not just the king and aristocrats. Simple people. You could walk down the street and say, oh, I accuse, I want Pierre's wine shop. I say, Pierre's an enemy of the people. And suddenly the mob goes crazy and they grab him and they go and they chop his head off, right? Because it's a demonic spirit. The revolutionary spirit's a demonic spirit. So we really have to understand what's really going on, you have to put aside these ideologies of democracy and equality and all that, it's really nonsense. And the people who created it knew it was nonsense, right? These are fairy tales for gullible people, right? And realize that these people, these revolutionists simply were, and today they remain criminals. They're just criminals. To understand why they for the people, for equality, no, they're just criminals.
For themselves.
Pardon me? Of course it's for themselves. Well, for themselves and for their father, the devil, right? What our Lord say, your father is the devil, to those who were attacking him.
Something about it, I've read somewhere that when they started the revolution, so-called, they stopped the bread. They used bread out of rice. Mm-hmm. Not rice, rye bread.
The French.
The bread. Mm-hmm. So what they've done, they stopped the supplies, mm-hmm. and they infected the rye with a mushroom. It was a hallucinogenic mushroom. So they send it to the villages, mm-hmm. and all of a sudden the people got crazy. And there was one agitator who said, "Hey, let's kill whatever."
So and so killed the local nobleman.
Exactly. So it lasted about 10 days, and after everything was destroyed. The effect of the hallucinogen wore out.
They realized what they had done.
Exactly.
Yeah.
They couldn't understand why.
Mm. I'd like to see the source for that. That's interesting.
We'll have to
find that. Well, next week, when we talk about the French Revolution, we'll talk about some important source material. Because there are a lot of things going on that people have no idea. And I'll talk next week about also where our common conceptions of the French Revolution come from. I know what they are in the English-speaking world. I don't know what they are in the Romanian intellectual world. But in the English-speaking world, it's just a couple of books that have dominated the popular conception of the French Revolution from the early 19th century until now. Okay. So these revolutionists are really just criminals. But they do use these ideas to capture people or to at least put a fig leaf, create a justification for what they're doing. And we know that as Richard Weaver's, the title of his book says, ideas do have consequences. Ideas do affect people. When people accept an idea and it grabs a hold of their mind, it does influence their behavior. So the progressive or so-called revolutionary ideology is in fact nonsense, right? It's a cover for criminality. But its component ideas are very powerful. These are very powerful ideas. And moreover, all of us are, or we were infected by these ideas. Because of our education, our upbringing, whether we were raised under communism or whether we were raised under soft Marxism, cultural Marxism in America, right? Either way, these ideas are part of our psyche, right? They're part of our assumptions. Okay, so we have to uproot these false ideas from our set of assumptions about the world before we can clearly see things from the Orthodox point of view. So let's examine just a few of the ideas. There are a lot of these ideas, but I picked out three. One is the so-called Whig theory of history. the model of history. Remember, we talked earlier in our class, one of our much earlier classes before we went into the Renaissance, we talked about models for understanding history. And the dominant model today, you call the liberal model or the progressive model or the Whig model. The Whig, because the Whigs were the so-called liberals in English politics and in the 19th century. And this is their theory of history. All their writers, their intellectuals put this forth. They're the ones who believed in muscular Christianity. You see? The Whigs were the progressive or liberal party in England from the late 17th to the 19th century. Their label is applied in general to a theory of history that they believed in, the progressive model that we've discussed before. Okay? And almost all contemporary people have this vague idea that this is how history works. It's very successful in capturing the minds of most of our civilization, right? According to this model, history involves a constant progression from lower and worse forms of the organization of human society to higher and higher forms. We're getting better every day in every way, right? Everything today is better than yesterday, and tomorrow will be better than today. So if you resist the change, since we know that things are going to be better tomorrow, if you resist change, that's because you're evil, right? Only evil people resist change. See? If you enable change, you're good. Of course, this isn't true, right? But it is a very powerful idea. Okay? It's an idol, right? All powerful ideas, all ideologies that capture people's minds and get them to focus on a fragment of reality and then make that into some kind of huge dominant force in their lives, right? It's an idol. It captures people's minds and it makes them feel righteous for destroying tradition. Also, destroying tradition is really easy. You know, it takes 2,000 years to create a tradition. It takes, you know, a year to destroy it. See, so it's cheap creativity, you might say. So it's a demonic creativity. Well, we can destroy all, we're going to destroy, look how creative we are. We're going to destroy all this. Our ancestors took 200 years to build this cathedral, but we're going to burn it down in 5 minutes. See? So they feel, it makes these undisciplined or vicious or simply degenerate people feel righteous for destroying tradition. And it makes the more conscientious people feel guilty for preserving it. Right? They feel guilty. They don't want to say anything. So that the anarchists and destroyers are emboldened, right? They're the good guys. And those on the side of the good are neutralized because if they say anything, they're the bad guys. If they fight back, they're the bad guys. See? So that's one bad idea, but it's a very powerful bad idea. Another bad idea is the obsession with equality, right? Which is a chimera. Equality is it's a total chimera, a will-o'-the-wisp. It's never existed. It never will exist. Okay? This extremely corrosive idea has been employed to destroy all traditional distinctions and structures in the name of justice for the oppressed. Right? You find an oppressed group. So these people are oppressed. We've got to destroy the system. Get rid of the king. Get rid of the nobility. Get rid of the church. Everybody's the same. Everybody's equal. Right? But we saw earlier, remember we were talking about the Protestant Reformation, we saw that there were these radical anarchist Protestant sects that would come into a city and in the name of equality and say, we don't want no bishops, we don't want no priests, we don't want no monks telling us what to do. We're going to kill all those people and we're going to have an equality where all the believers are equal. But then out of those believers, there'd be one tyrant who would take over and start killing all of it, killing everybody, including his followers. You see, because as a matter of fact, there always has to be a hierarchy. Life is hierarchical, right? God designed it that way. It's just the way it is. It's just, we have to be humble and realistic. Realize, well, life is hierarchical, right? There are always people in charge and people who are following people in charge.
It's like the body.
It's the body, yeah. What St. Paul say?
Yeah.
The foot shouldn't say to the head, well, I'm not the head. I'm not important. No, it's all important, right? But it's in its place. Everybody's important, but they're in there fulfilling their role. In the family, of course, they really, their goal, once they get rid of the traditional civil structures or military structures, church structures, then they go after the real, they go after the family. That's the real, just destroy human love at the root, which is in the structure of the family. And the family, of course, is hierarchical. Then they should say men and women are the same, husbands and wives are the same, children shouldn't have to listen to their parents, children can do what they want. If you tell the child what to do, you're a child abuser, and so forth and so on, right? So this radical so-called equality destroys the possibility for love. That's why you know, Weaver, in his book, he says something very correct, which is, he says, you know, the French Revolution, their motto was liberty, equality, fraternity. But equality and fraternity don't go together. Fraternity means love, right? Fraternity means brotherliness, love, relationship, right? But once you have equality, life is where nobody's responsible for anybody else. I don't have to obey you. You don't have to take care of me. Or you don't have to obey me. I don't have to take care of you. Everybody, it's every man for himself. See? Then it becomes the law of the jungle. And they end up creating a nasty, evil hierarchy, because life has to be, somebody has to be in charge. But instead of the traditional people being in charge, instead of the bishops and the priests and the nuns of being example, and the king or the leader, the chieftain, whoever he is, feeling a relationship of love and tradition and blood and for his people, right? It's just some guy who grabs power because he wants power. See? And these structures that were nurtured for centuries but under the church and through the loving sacrifice of so many ancestors, it's destroyed. And so you just have the lowest elements of the society, the most anarchistic, most criminalistic elements, take over, because they're the ones who have no conscience. See? So where there's a conscious struggle for equality, there can only be strife, competition and strife. The word competition has to be understood. I'm not against all competition, right? Without competition, we wouldn't grow. But by competition, I should really modify that, instead of competition, to be aggression or constant fighting, right? And strife, the survival of the fittest, right? The Darwinian model. And it's not a sheer coincidence that Darwinism comes to the fore in the 19th century, right? There were Darwinistic ideas even in the 18th century. And then in the 19th century, which is the full blossoming of the age of revolution, what's the new theory about the origin of life, about a new philosophy for to explain everything? Evolution, survival of the fittest.
Right? It was formalized.
It was just formalized, yeah. But love is possible only where there are distinctions and hierarchy, right? If I'm in charge, I'm responsible for you. I have to sacrifice myself for you. If I'm in charge of you, you have to obey me. Or if you're in charge of me, I obey you and you're responsible for me. It's that simple. See, and that's, life is like that. Of course, there are fraternal relationships. There are relationships of people on the same level, of course. But there are also degrees of hierarchy within family, church, society, nation, everywhere. Okay. The preachers of equality actually don't believe in equality. Remember, these are all myths or fairy tales, right? These are ideological fig leaves, covers for what they're really doing, right? They don't believe in equality. They know it's absurd. They know it's impossible. All of human experience tells you it's impossible, going back millennia, right, to the dawn of time. Okay? But they use it as a weapon to destroy traditional relationships, to install their new ruthless, conscienceless, cold-hearted relationships, right? Their tyranny. Okay, so that's my another bad idea is the so-called sovereign will of the people. The sovereign will of the people. Okay, they always claim, but what they're doing is for the people. This is for the people. But as we know from our communist revolutions, it's never for all the people. It's always for a little group of the people who had everything, right? Who got to control everything. Okay. Well, you told me something funny, Mr. Constantine, about the champagne. What's champagne? That's something that the...
Is the drink which people drink through their representatives.
Through their representatives. The vanguard of the proletariat will drink the champagne and we'll go, oh, we're so happy that our vanguard is drinking.
In the name of
the people, right? In the name of the people. So the revolutionists always proclaim that the people are sovereign. You know, all mobs love that. A demagogue gets up and says, you're a sovereign, you're the boss, you're my boss. Yeah! They're all screaming, right? Yeah, that's right. You know, we're sovereign, we're the boss. And that we must have democracy instead of monarchy and traditional hierarchy and so forth.
Elections.
If we just have more elections, if just more and more people vote and we have more and more elections, there'll be more freedom, happiness, prosperity, and less bad breath and everybody will have high IQs and everything. good toothpaste, iPhones. Be kingdom come. So this includes the idea that the problem with this, there are several problems with the sovereign will of the people. But one is the idea that authority comes from below, or not from above. Right? And it's a radically false idea, because all legitimate authority descends right from God. Okay. It's also very dishonest, because the proclaimers of the will of the people always claim that they alone, this tiny group, express the will of the people, and if any number of people get in their way, they're going to kill all of them. And we saw this with every one of these revolutions. We're doing it for the people, but you're killing all the people. Yeah, but we're doing it for the people. Okay. But they've succeeded in convincing vast numbers of people that so-called democracy is good, that traditional authority is bad. Okay. And if only everyone could vote and everyone had civil rights, all would be well.
As long as they vote, those guys in power, yes.
Pardon me?
As long as they vote, the guys in power.
As long as they're the ones. Well, you present, they're the people in power and then the controlled opposition. And they just keep trading, taking turns, right? To present this shadow puppet play, you know, of freedom and democracy and so forth. Okay. So this is a radically false idea, but it forms a bedrock assumption for our contemporaries. This unholy triad of falsehoods are three of the most important ideas that had consequences for the destruction of the Christian order in Europe and its replacement by secularism, which is really a demonic nightmare. Now, there are good ideas that have consequences. We're about to study the present age of revolution, the age of open revolt against God, and the creation of an aggressively intolerant regime of secularism across the face of the earth. As part of our survival toolkit, we not only have to throw out bad ideas, but we have to be convinced of good ideas, right? Turn away. The Psalm says, turn away from evil and do good. We can't just be negative and say, that's bad, that's bad, that's bad. So, well, that's bad. We have to throw it out, but nature pours a vacuum. You have to fill it with what's good. So we have to have good ideas, truths, which will comfort and strengthen us and enable us to understand and respond to the world around us. That first good idea is a true Christian model of history, which we spoke of earlier, and that I think it was class 10, where we spoke of a false and true models of history. So I'm going to review that progressive model again, which is a bad model, and then we're going to talk about an orthodox Christian model of history. So I'm going to review this again, since which we talked about in class 10. So there's the progressive model, which is the false model that we just talked about earlier, the Whig model of history. I referred to this above as the Whig theory of history. This can also be called the evolutionary or optimistic model. We're getting better and better every way and every day. We're getting better and better. Okay. Here, everything starts with original blob or Urstuff or whatever. It's all wrapped up with evolution, see? And everything evolves into higher and higher, better and better forms of everything towards some bright future. Or when you're a little kid in the classroom in a communist country, and they talk about the bright future, you know, that one day if we just sacrifice ourselves and, you know, for socialism, then one day all will be well and our descendants will have equality and democracy.
Next generation.
Pardon me?
Next.
Well, the next generation. It's always the next generation. Yes. But it never happens, right? The horizon's always receding. So it starts with this inorganic blob and it evolves into the most advanced civilizations. Then even going out to the planets and stars and colonizing them and so forth and so on indefinitely to some kind of secular eternity that will never end. That's the vision of eternity. Other people are obsessed with space. That's their secular eternity, right? Man, just going to higher and higher forms and greater technology and going out and colonizing Mars and the distant stars and so forth and so on. That's one reason why people are obsessed with these Star Wars and Star Trek movies. It's a form of religion. It's a substitute for authentic transcendence. Right? It's kind of fake eternity because they're cut off from the true kingdom of heaven and from the true experience of eternity.
From reality?
And, well, certainly from reality, yes.
This Tesla guy is just pushing it.
Pardon me?
This Tesla guy. Tesla.
Tesla was pushing.
No, Tesla car.
Oh, not poor Nikola Tesla. Oh, Elon Musk or whatever his name is. Yes.
He said, vision.
Yes. Where I go?
3-4 years from now, we go to Mars.
Yes, we're going to have to go to Mars and on and on. Yeah. If you want to see sort of the classic artistic expression of this, it's this famous movie by Stanley Kubrick called 2001 Space Odyssey, which is filmed in 1968, 1969. And by today's technological standards, it's a sort of primitive movie technology by current computer-generated graphic standards. But this is a very powerful movie. I was 12 or 13 years old when this came out, so 69 or 70, around that time. And it came at the height of the whole hippie movement in America and the drug movement and people going to gurus and so forth and so on, but also at the height of the space program, right? This whole thing, 1969, that was the year of Apollo 11, right? The moon landing. And so it was
so cool.
It was just another topic. But it was this giant 2001 Space Odyssey was this huge propaganda piece, right, to convince people of that man's true eternity, man's true purpose is to evolve into something higher and live on other planets and so forth and so on. And it's an open proclamation of Darwinism. It starts out, those who've seen the movie, remember, it's unforgettable, right? It starts out with these apes that are hopping around, and they can't get what they want to eat, and then they don't know how to use weapons. They can't kill an animal in order to eat, and so suddenly this vast monolith appears. This great huge gray stone appears, and it starts sending out. It sends out sound waves. Whoa! And the monkeys are covering their ears, and suddenly the monkeys start looking like this. They look intelligent. And they start tying knots with twigs, and they pick up a jawbone or a bone, and they realize, they look at the bone and realize that it's a weapon, and they kill a tapir with the weapon, and they can eat. And then the ape, now of course now he's an ape man, right? He's a semi man or whatever, Australopithecus or whatever, Java man or whatever it's become, and then it throws its bone up into the air. And the bone flips end on end, and the bone becomes, suddenly you flip to 2001, and it's a spaceship. And it's going to the moon, or going to a space station. See? And so this is but for an American my age, this is an emblem of our coming to age, right? Our cinematic initiation into the religion of evolution and the religion of man in space as eternity, right? So this is the dominant model of today's power elite, or at least what they brainwash everyone else into believing. I mean, they know they're just going to die and go to hell. I mean, which is why they're willing to kill any number of babies to get stem cells to try to stay alive for another 5 minutes, right? But they tell everybody that this is the future, right? This is your future. They probably know it's ridiculous, but some main corollaries of this idea are: the past is bad, the future is good, but the future is never here. It's always the next generation. It's always beyond the horizon, right? So we have to keep progressing. Change is ceaseless. Stasis is impossible. Whatever we are thinking and doing today is always better than what people thought or did in the past. But we must think and do differently tomorrow than what we are thinking and doing today. Okay? Of course, politically, this always means there's a new orthodoxy and there's a new heresy. Yesterday's orthodoxy was heresy, so we got to kill the heretics, right? So that's why the next generation is always running at the previous generation, shooting them or putting them in the jail or sending them to the gulag or whatever, or just having them declared insane, put in mental hospitals. Okay. So the only virtue is to submit. Right? This is a juggernaut. This is inevitable. It's determined. You have to submit to it. You have to jump on the juggernaut or get crushed. And the only vice is to oppose it. To be a reactionary, a counter-revolutionary, or of course, nowadays,
a fundamentalist,
a terrorist, whatever. Okay, so if you get in the way of progress, you're bad. If you cooperate with progress, you're good. That's the only virtues left. Is just the only sin. Of course, they don't use the word sin. That's an outmoded word, right? The only bad thing, the only unacceptable behavior left is to oppose this progress. And if you don't believe in it, you're either a heretic or mentally ill. Either they have to burn you at the stake, they have to kill you, or they have to put you in the loony bin, right? Either way, you have to be dealt with, right? Now, there are two main variants of this model, okay? One is deterministic and fatalistic, leaving no room for human decision. It's more consistent. That's the Marxist, or Hegelian, if you're a liberal, say it's Hegelian. This is more consistent. But the other is the Christian humanist model, right? Christian humanists who say that do-gooders have to work to advance the march of history. We're do-gooders. We're good. Okay. These people are superficially admirable. They can be very nice. You know, they can volunteer and do volunteer work and be very concerned about the environment or the poor or something like that. But they're admirable in a Disney movie sort of way, right? They're silly, right? They're deluded, and they usually make up the demographic of so-called useful idiots that the real revolutionaries contemptuously do away with. Right? Once you're in a real Marxist state, they have no more use for liberals. They've got to go. So all the Russian liberals realized this in the 20s and fled to Paris, where they could go on having their decadent, silly life as liberals and not be bothered by the real revolutionaries who would be quite willing to shoot them. Okay. And all these Paris liberals found it infected and took over St. Vladimir's Seminary. But that's another story. Okay. So the real revolutionaries contemptuously do away with the useful idiots. But the useful idiots, their purpose is not only to advance progress, but to hollow out the church from the inside. Right? They hollow the church from the inside. That's one model. That's a bad model. A second model we talked about is a model of inevitable decline. That's a pessimistic model. This can be called a nostalgic or pessimistic model of history. Here, everything starts with an original perfection, a golden age, in which everything subsequently declined. This decline, like progress, is inevitable. Okay, so again, this is not a Christian idea. This is a secular idea, but it's an idea identified with secular conservatism, secular traditionalism. People are getting stupider and more evil all the time. Morality, art, politics, all cultural manifestations get lower and lower. And finally, there's this Götterdämmerung, right, where everything is destroyed, a final catastrophic destruction of everything. This model appeals only to aristocratic and noble souls who are willing to fight on, knowing they will be defeated in the end. People like this actually hardly exist anymore. When the cataclysms of the 20th century basically performed a demographic genocide on the aristocracy of Europe and the United States, this type of person disappeared. You can read their memoirs, but they don't exist anymore. So I'm only mentioning this model as a theoretically. The people who believe in this really have all been slaughtered, or just their children don't believe it anymore. Unlike progressivism, whose elite does not really believe in progress, but only their own lust for power, and who use progress to delude the masses, declineism attracts a sincerely believing and necessarily tiny elite who don't have Christian hope. They're not Christians. They might be. They were all nominally Christians. They were all baptized Catholics or Protestants or something, or in some cases Orthodox. Right? But they want to do the right thing, right? They revere the church. They revere the monarchy. They revere their nation. They just don't believe in Christ. See, you meet these are in Greece. We have people like this. They're very elderly now. The generation that really believe in Greece, but all that orthodoxy. Yeah, well, that's good. You know, that's good for the old ladies and the children. But we believe in Greece. See, but this kind of person is disappearing, right? Because it can't be sustained. It doesn't have spiritual power. Okay. The ethics of Stoicism and some forms, sometimes existentialism, fit in with this model. In this model, virtue consists in doing your duty in the face of final defeat. It's duty. Okay, but duty is the ethic of Stoicism. Right? Only a small aristocracy trained to virtue understand this duty. Their happiness lies in doing it till the end. They know that the herd will never improve, right? They're the chosen aristocracy. They're going to do their duty to the end. And vice is the normal state of the majority, who are hopelessly corrupt, and of the aristocrats who abandon their duty and join the herd. Now, unlike the pedestrian and fatuous, silly, right, self-indulgent stupidity of progressivism, this view is a noble view. It's heroic. Right? It's lofty. It invites the sympathy of better minds. But it's also not true. So ultimately, it's powerless. And thank God it's not true, because we have hope. We believe in Christ. Okay. So now let's talk about the good idea. The first good idea that I want to talk about tonight is this Model 3, which is the true model of history. Original goodness, sin, temporal decline, eternal triumph. This so-called model or view of history we find in the Bible, in the Holy Fathers. That's where we go for the truth, for our good ideas, for our survival toolkit. Right? This is the only complete model because it takes into account the invisible as well as the visible realm. These other two models, so they're opposed to each other. One is so-called left, one is so-called right. These other two models, but they're both secular. They're both worldly. Right? But this, the Christian model, is neither one or the other. The Christian model is from God. Right? And it takes into account the invisible realm. And remember, we're not just material creatures. We're also angelic creatures. So the invisible realm is where the more important part of our life takes place, even though we're not in touch with it most of the time. Okay? So the Christian model offers the only satisfyingly comprehensive understanding, sympathetic but realistic, sympathetic but realistic, of man's capacity for both good and evil. Okay? The first two models are this worldly. They don't admit divine providence. Okay? The first model is stupidly optimistic about human goodness. Whatever new nonsense a human being comes up with must be good because it's new, right? And sin is unknown, an unknown concept. The second model, the Stoic or aristocratic model, is sadly pessimistic. Man's just doomed. That's all there is to it. There is sin. That's all there is, just sin out there and then a few of us doing our duty, and that's it. Only this third model offers the real solution to the whole thing. Man was created good. He fell. He mixes evil with whatever good he does. Right? Every good we do has some poison in it, right? It has some evil mixed in it. Right? Man can never this. The only perfect man is Jesus Christ. Right? Without Christ, man can't do good. His good is always, no matter how hard he tries, his good is always mixed with evil. Okay. He can't save himself. Man needs a savior. But we have a savior. And we can overcome evil through the Savior's grace, through the grace of Christ. Right? History is not this long march of progress, and it's not just this long decline. History is up and down. Right? The outward tendency being mostly down, and generally people, it's kind of gone down, right? But inwardly, often very triumphant. Right? Every life of a saint is a triumph, right? Every virtue. Every saved soul. Ultimately, after things can't possibly get any worse, that is the reign of Antichrist, right? God will triumph cosmically and eternally. Or rather, God has already triumphed. That's what we're celebrating now. We're in the Paschal period. That Christ has risen. He's already triumphed. He's already refashioned the entire cosmos through his resurrection. He has triumphed and he will triumph in his second coming and the inauguration of a new heaven and a new earth. Only this model takes into account that the most important historical processes are invisible. They're inward. They're going on in the angelic universe in which man is also a participant through the struggle within his own soul. Okay, so each of us, baptized Orthodox Christians, we have this spiritual life in which God's grace is inside of us and our guardian angel is influencing us. God's grace is enlightening us. Right? But then also the powers of evil are trying to pull us away, and there's this drama within each soul, and this drama within the soul is the actual mechanism of history, because it's God working through his saints to bring holiness into the world, and the devil working through his minions, both visible and invisible, to bring evil into the world, are in this great warfare for the souls of men. That's for real history. That's why, you know, Solzhenitsyn, after all that he went through in the Gulag, finally he said, you know, The line between good and evil goes right down the middle of the heart of every man. That's what's really going on. People say, well, you Orthodox, you have these monks, and they go off and they live in monasteries, and what are they doing for society? Well, they're doing the most important thing. They're entering into the invisible warfare with our worst enemies. We're the leaders of all of our visible enemies. So all our visible enemies, whether they're criminals, or they're anarchists, or are they're tyrants, they're oppressive governments, or they're greedy corporations, or whoever these enemies are, anti-Christian populations, whoever they are, they're just outward manifestations. They're just the visible servants of our real enemies, right? And who are the enemies of every man. We'll never be really sympathetic with people until we realize that everybody is a victim of the devil. Everybody's a victim of the devil. Okay. Outward temporal processes are but manifestations of this invisible inward struggle. So as we go through this sad story of the contemporary age of revolution, okay, with the 20th century, when we get to the 20th century, hundreds of millions of people murdered, right? Often by their own governments. Okay, governments using their own people, their own cousins, to pull the lever or to shoot the gun and kill them. Okay. As we go through this sad story, all of our studies should aim at giving us realism, yes, realism, right? Be realistic. But more importantly, hope. All things are under God's providence. All things tend to his final victory. God is sovereign. Not the will of the people. Right? The people aren't sovereign. The devil is certainly not sovereign. God is sovereign. Okay. That's the first good idea, a true understanding of history, of our beginnings, our present stage, state, and our hope, our future. Another important idea is to remember the distinction between primary goods and secondary evils versus primary evils and secondary goods. In his introduction to Russia's Catacomb Saints, a very important book that's unfortunately out of print right now, or has been for some time.
It's on the internet.
It is on the internet, yes. If you can search Russia's Catacomb Saints, this is the first complete collection in English, the first significant collection in English of lives of people who were murdered by the Bolsheviks in Russia. But Father Seraphim's introduction, as with many of his books, when he does a translation, his introduction is almost as important as the translation because of the insight that it gives. Right? So Father Seraphim Rose speaks of the importance of understanding that there is an ordered hierarchy, again, hierarchy, right? An ordered hierarchy of goods and evils, that we must always choose primary goods, even if they are accompanied by secondary evils. We must always choose primary goods, even if they're accompanied by secondary evils. Okay. There were always secondary evils in societies ordered according to the Christian order, poverty and justice. We shouldn't look back and say, Byzantium or Holy Russia or Holy Romania, Holy Greece, whatever, and say it was beautiful, it was a paradise, it was perfect. That's totally unrealistic. Insofar as Russia is concerned, you just read Russian literature and see how these people are horrible. I often tell people that there are so many saints in Russia because there's so many horrible people to persecute them. And so there was always sin. Nobody should claim that there were no sinners. There was no sin, no evil, no injustice, no oppression in Byzantium or in other historical Orthodox societies. There were always secondary evils in societies, poverty, injustice, and so forth. But there was the primary good of God's law being the guiding philosophy of the society. And grace, the primary good above all of grace, of the church's dominant influence, and the grace flowing from the church to the people, to the very soil, to the rivers, to the air. Okay. The anti-Christian revolution uses the excuse of secondary evils to destroy Christian order and to institute as the solution a primary evil, an antichrist tyranny, as the order of society. We're going to get rid of injustice and oppression, and to do so, we're going to get rid of all the traditional structures and the king and the church and the family, and we're going to get rid of all those problems. Our way, well, their way, we know what their way is, right? So we must never be taken in, or we should never feel guilty, right? And one of their tools, their tool with degenerate people is to appeal to their passions, but their tool with noble or Christian souls is to appeal to their sense of guilt, make you feel guilty. Okay.
There is an example we cannot mention.
Yeah, we should never feel guilty about the past of our church or of our nations, right? Even if people are sinful. If people say, well, there was this injustice, say, well, you're just proving the point that I believe as a Christian. There's sin. Right? Sin exists. Such a thing, sin. Yeah, we know about sin. But you're going to get rid of sin by killing what helps us control our sins, which is the church. Okay. So we must never be taken in by this propaganda about Christian society being oppressive to certain groups, because the supposed evils being attacked, if the evils did exist, which some did, some didn't, right? Some are purely imaginary or false propaganda. Some are real, but they're exaggerated, so forth. At the most, they're secondary evils, and often do not exist or are not evil at all. Actually, weren't even evil. Okay. So remember, primary goods. Primary focus. Keep your eye on that. Primary goods, and maybe accompanied by secondary evils. But if you destroy the primary goods to get rid of the secondary evils, you introduce primary evils, and you arrive at only secondary goods. Even if you get them, even if there's more grain for the poor, which often is not the case, they didn't get either one. They didn't get the primary good or the secondary good. But even if they had more grain for the poor after they destroyed the church and killed the king and so forth, they've still destroyed a primary good for the sake of just having more grain, right? Which is a secondary good. Okay. A final thing I want to talk about tonight is this route that truth remains the truth no matter how few people believe it. Truth, you can't vote on what's the truth, right? Even if 99 out of 100 people say something's true, if it's not true, it's not true. And if one person says, hey, that's true, it's still true. Okay. The demonic progress of Western philosophy, as we've been seeing in our study, with going back to nominalism back in the 14th century, and then Descartes, Locke, Hume, Kant, all the philosophers we've mentioned, it's created in people's minds the idea that truth is what you make it to be. Everyone has become Pontius Pilate. Huh, what's truth? Since truth is relative, right? That's the motto. Truth is relative. And actually, if you tell me my truth isn't true, you're oppressing me. You're an oppressor. Right? So you have to be done away with, right? Since truth is relative, the only criteria for believing anything are not related to truth at all, but simply to expedience. I believe it because if I don't, I'll get into trouble, or I'll lose my job, or I'll starve, I won't have any friends. Okay. So I develop a delusional world of false beliefs, and I feel righteous about it. I love Big Brother. Right? The end of 1984, where Winston Smith's finally, he cracked under torture, and finally he's sitting drinking his watered-down gin and looking at the television. Big Brother's giving a speech, and he realizes, oh, finally, I feel so good, I love Big Brother. Right, no more conflict, no more tension. I love Big Brother. Okay. If today Big Brother says white is white, that's true. But if tomorrow he says white is black, not only is that true, but it's always been true. Okay. Or today, you know, people say there's no such thing as a man or a woman. You decide whether to be a man or a woman. Well, I don't believe that. How can you not believe that? Well, you didn't believe it last year. Oh, yeah, but I really believe it now. Well, why? what scientific evidence has demonstrated that this is now true? Well, it is true, you see, because they can't resist the propaganda. Of course, it's very important to understand the vast mass of people throughout history has only believed in principles or ideas endorsed and enforced by a ruling elite, because that's the way people are. That's why leadership is so important. Missionaries would go and convert the king. Right? That's the way people are. And that's not to be contemptuous of people or degrade people. I'm not putting people down. I'm saying that's the way human beings are. Human beings follow a leadership. Okay. So we have to understand that why did God institute a hierarchical church? Because people always follow leaders. We just look at all of history. People follow the leading class. Okay? Human life is hierarchical. There's nothing that can change that. The only difference is whether the rulers are good or evil and whether they're telling the truth or not. Even a very sinful ruler, say Ivan the Terrible, if he was as bad as they say he was, which some Russians disagree with that. I don't want to get into that. But let's assume that Ivan the Terrible really, all the bad things he did really are true. And I'll have some Russians attacking me now because there's now a whole cult now to rehabilitate Ivan the Terrible. But that's beside the point. I'm just using him as an example. Let's just say Ivan the Terrible was so bad and killed all these people and so forth. He was really bad. Okay, but remember, those are secondary evils. Primarily, he's right believing and he's telling the people the truth. He never denied orthodoxy. He told the people the truth. And so even though he was rough and killed people, he upheld orthodoxy as the truth. And people followed the Tsar, and they followed the Metropolitan and the Patriarch and so forth because people follow their leaders. Okay, so it's very, very important for the leaders to tell the truth. And when they don't, it's really bad. Okay, and you have to be very brave to be the one who says, you know, I'm sorry, I don't believe that. I'm sorry, but he's wrong. Okay. When the rulers are evil, when they enforce an evil orthodoxy of anti-truth, then to know and believe and confess the truth becomes very difficult. You're the bad guy, okay, if you disagree. But it's the only path open to our conscience, right? If we want to follow our conscience, to obey God's law, to love God, to do what he wants, we have to follow our conscience.
You become to John the Baptist. You have to take whatever comes.
You have to take whatever comes, yes. Be the voice in the wilderness, right? So as Orthodox Christians, we know that the truth is absolute. He has revealed himself. The truth is not simply an idea. The truth is Christ. He's a person. Our Lord said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Our Lord is the truth. Okay. Christ, the word and wisdom of God, the way, the truth, and the life. And coming from the Logos, the word of God, from the truth, is an entire beautiful ensemble of derivative truths about life, reality, society, family, everything. There's what Father Serafin and before him, a revered spiritual father, Archbishop André of Rockland, often called the Orthodox philosophy of life, an Orthodox philosophy of life. So we have our dogmatic truths, moral truths, right? Then we also have and truths about the way to organize our lives, right? We fail often because of the world we live in, because we're very secular, we're very worldly, but it's all there. We must constantly study this holy truth, both in prayer and the church services and direct reading of Holy Scriptures, church fathers, and teachers. We must apply the understanding we receive from the Lord to our life, family, work, community, everything, to the greatest extent possible in our circumstances. We must never be afraid to tell the truth. The hard thing is to change ourselves, right? To realize how much we've conformed to this world and how much we have to unconform, right? St. John the Apostle says in his epistle, children, do not love the world. Right? St. Paul says, don't be conformed to the world. Right? So, and we have to be not unafraid to tell the truth, but to just tell the truth. Okay. Now, we know we must not throw our pearls before swine. We have to be prudent about who we tell the truth to. You can't just run down the street saying, oh, the truth, because either they'll say you're crazy or they'll lock you up, or you will have no effect at all. But you pray for the Lord for discernment, to know hearts, minds, souls that are open, and also who you're responsible for. Right? That's a hierarchy too, who you're responsible for and not responsible for. And we must ask the Lord for discernment to know when and how to speak, but we must speak. That's why we're having these classes, right? To speak. The Lord will give us the guidance and strength that we need to speak the truth. So these good ideas, to understand that God is sovereign of history and we have hope, and that we must always distinguish between primary and secondary goods and primary and secondary evils, and that the truth is the truth. There is truth, and that we're responsible for knowing it, learning more and more of it, expressing it with our lives. And then the more we conform our lives to the truth, the more God's grace covers us, right? When you don't try to do it the world's way, you do it God's way, it may be difficult, but God's grace covers, and a door opens, and you go through the door. But you never know it's going to open to the last second, and then it opens, and you go through it, okay? And because salvation ultimately is an adventure, so we have to be hopeful, and we have to be brave.